Well, good morning. As we come in this final days of our Veterans Day weekend, we have a chance to honor our veterans as a part of our service today, but also to hear the story of a God who liberates all of us into joy and life and peace. And so as you come and worship today, we're able to come and to worship in the freedoms that we have that protect that, but also to come and to celebrate a God who sets us free from all things in life. And so if you've come looking for healing today, then I pray that you find it. If you've come looking for community, I know that you'll find it. If you've come looking for grace and peace that we might be filled up and be ready to be poured out for this world, then it's my pleasure to be able to worship alongside you this week as we're ready to do the good work of building the kingdom of God here in Alabaster. Some amazing things that are going on in the life of the church. There's some announcements on the back of your bulletin of service projects and meals that are coming up and new classes. One particular one that we're really excited about is our Men of the Word Bible study is going to be hosting our dinner this week for our Wednesday night dinner. They're going to be doing hot dogs, chili, and all the fixins. 5 p.m. in the fellowship hall. So if you're able to come on Wednesday to be able to come and to have dinner with us, the reservations are due by noon tomorrow. If you've got a chance to call into the church office to let us know, but the dinner will be a donation based and go towards the proceeds to help support our men's ministry and their work through the year. So be sure to come out and to be a part of that if you can. But as we go through what God is doing here today, through the course of our worship, let us begin in opening our worship today. Will you rise for our call to worship this morning? There is none like you, O Lord, nor are there any work like yours. All the nations you have made shall come and bow down before you, O Lord.
We shall glorify your name.
Amen. And let us keep that glory going with our hymn of praise as we continue standing as you're able, God of the ages.
God of the ages, Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. I'd like to remind everyone that we have our angel trees out. There's one in the breezeway here in the Founding Church building, and there's also one over in the Restore entry area. If you are interested in helping, or maybe you have a small group, a Sunday school class, a workplace group that's interested in helping make one child's Christmas extra special, you can choose an ornament off of the tree, and please don't forget to sign it out. There's a notebook on the table out here where you sign that out. We will help close to 100 children this year from our community have a Merry Christmas, and we thank you for the way that you always pour yourself out for this ministry each and every year. The gifts will be due back on December the 4th. You just bring them back and put them under the trees in either space. It doesn't matter where you got the ornament. You can just put your gifts in either space. But thank you again for participating in this and all of our other ministries. We would like to thank you, too, for the way that you show up. You show up here to worship with us and to study with us in our small groups. You show up in our service projects. You show up out in the world and witness to what you believe in. And you show up in prayer for this church, this community. And you show up in the ways that you give, and we thank you for that. As the ushers come forward, I remind you that the money that you give helps keep the church running, but it also helps us do good work in our community and throughout the world through the connection we have in the United Methodist Church. May God richly bless the gifts and the givers of all types this morning. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
He did. Before we go to God in prayer this morning, we want to recognize all of the individuals within our community here at this church who have given of part of their lives to serve in our military forces. And so we have a video that we want to share to recognize all of those individuals.
Thank you.
And I know that some of these individuals are here or within us today, and so we just ask for you to stand as we can show you our appreciation for those that have served. I know there are a couple. I just saw the video. Yes, sir. Absolutely. And we're so glad they did. And so we thank all of those individuals who have served so that we may be sitting here today with one of the wonderful freedoms of worshiping our God. And so we thank you all, and we come to a time where we go to prayer to our God. So let's pray. Almighty and gracious God, Lord, we come to you today grateful to be a part of your creation, grateful that we continually know that you are present within our lives and that we are loved by you. And we come to you today knowing without a doubt that you, our God, are alive and at work just as much today as you ever have been, and that you will continue to be alive and at work in the days to come. And Lord, we ask that you use each and every one of us here to your service in the world, that we may be vessels of your hope, of your grace, of your love. Because, Lord, we know that we are not perfect. We know that we have moments where we fall short. But yet you still love us in a way in which we cannot even comprehend. And so we thank you. We lift up on this Veterans Day weekend all of those who have served so that we may be sitting here today worshiping you, our God. And Lord, as we continue to grow closer to you and grow in our understanding of you, let us continue to shine the light of Christ in a world that seems to only have darkness around it. Because, Lord, we are your people. And our hope and our prayer, just as it is yours, is that all of your children and all of your people will know of your love and will feel you surrounding them. And so as a community of faith on this morning, Lord, we just join our voices together to pray the words that Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And so now we want to invite the children to come down to the steps for Children's Moment with Miss Rachel today.
Thank you. Good morning. How are y'all? Good. I hope y'all are going to be a little bit more talkative than my 8:30 crew. They just stared at me. Okay, so can some of y'all tell me something that makes you happy? Pastor Arthur says tacos. What's something that makes you happy? Your mama? That's sweet. Okay, what about, does anybody know something that they get excited about or look forward to that's not here yet? Reese. Parties, that's a good one. Anybody else got anything? What's something else you might get excited about? Jackson. Toys. Yeah, that's a good one. I know my boys are always really excited for their birthday. You know, they like plan it out a whole year in advance. We already know what they want to do next July and September. So, what about hope? Do any of y'all know what the word hope means? Abigail. Good. Yeah. She said you want it. It's something that you want. You hope that it gets there. So that's a good example. So like at the 8:30 service, I told him, like your mom or somebody's cooking a good dinner, but you hope it's pizza. Or you have a present. You hope it's that hoverboard or bicycle you've been wanting. It's something you can look forward to, right? So today in our Bible story, it's about Isaiah, and he was a prophet, and he was in charge or with the Israelites, and they were going through a really hard time. They were captured by their enemies, and they didn't live where they wanted to live at that time. So they just were not happy. So he was giving them words of hope and promises from God. So he promised them that one day they would live where they wanted to live and that they would get along with their enemy. He also promised them about Jesus. And Isaiah didn't know when Jesus was coming because this was in the Old Testament, but God did. And because of Jesus, we can have hope too, right? So I want y'all to remember with the holidays coming up that we can have joy and hope because of Jesus all the time. So y'all pray with me and then we'll go to Children's Church. Dear God, thank you for the hope of new life. Thank you for the comfort and joy and most of all your son Jesus. In his precious and holy name we pray, amen.
Amen. And so the kids, if your child is going to Children's Church with Miss Rachel, you'll go out this door down the hallway and they'll be in one of the classrooms on the educational hallway down here. But as we continue on through worship today, let us stand and join our voices together in our hymn of preparation, America the Beautiful.
Thank you.
Let us remain standing and join together in our prayer for illumination before we hear our scripture today. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen.
Today's scripture is from Isaiah chapter 65, verses 17 to 25. For I am about to create new heavens and a new earth. The former things shall not be remembered or come to mind, but be glad and rejoice forever in what I am creating. For I am about to create Jerusalem as a joy and its people as a delight. I will rejoice in Jerusalem and delight in my people. No more shall the sound of weeping be heard in it, or the cry of distress. No more shall there be in it an infant that lives but a few days, or an old person who does not live out a lifetime. For one who dies at 100 years will be considered a youth, and one who falls short of 100 will be considered accursed. They shall build houses and inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards and eat their fruit. They shall not build and another inhabit. They shall not plant and another eat. For like the days of a tree shall the days of my people be, and my chosen shall long enjoy the work of their hands. They shall not labor in vain, or bear children for calamity, for they shall be offspring blessed by the Lord, and their descendants as well. Before they call, I will answer. While they are yet speaking, I will hear. The wolf and the lamb shall feed together. The lion shall eat straw like the ox, but the serpent, its food shall be dust. They shall not hurt or destroy on all my holy mountain, says the Lord. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Send your word, O Lord, like the rain falling down upon the earth. Send your word, O Lord, like the rain falling down upon the earth.
You may be seated. So I was raised by two military veterans as parents. My mother is a veteran of the United States Air Force, where she served as a nurse. My father is a veteran of the United States Army, where he served as an explosive ordnance technician. Took bombs apart. So one person's job was to make sure that situations didn't blow up, and the other one was to put it back together when they did. And it was interesting being raised with two incredible parents who had such incredible lessons to be able to pass on. For those of you that maybe have two veterans that helped raise you, you always got into the unique circumstances. They got to argue about who outranked the other one. Now, my mother served to the rank of captain. My dad, he ended up retiring as a command sergeant major. So I'm a major in the Army Reserve, so I outrank both of them now. But that's why I said that to you here and not at home. But it was unique in that we got to experience a lot of different things, got to see a lot of different things. I got to really learn a lot of life lessons that I think helped change and transform my life. And nowadays, I get to try to pass them on to my daughters. So the other day, my two girls and I, we were playing around online, and we came across the word resilience. And so my daughters asked me, what is resilience? And I said, resilience is the ability to kind of bounce up against an obstacle or a challenge and still kind of find a way around it, to bump up against something that you didn't anticipate happening, you didn't want to happen. But when you encounter difficulty, resilience means your entire life doesn't fall apart whenever things go wrong. And one of my daughters, I won't say which one, looked me in the eye and said, Dad, I do not have that. And we said, I know. But it's a learnable skill. It's one that you work on. It's one that you learn through life, that you encounter difficulties, and after a while, you come up with other solutions to be able to try to go around them. And that's one of the things that I think both my mother and my father were really good at being able to teach us, that a lot of the things that come from not only their military background, but even parenting or their three children, kind of came around the idea that if you start with the goal in mind, if you start out with what it is you want to achieve, then a lot of times, in order to get there, you need to adapt. You need to overcome. You need to be creative in the way that you're still able to accomplish the mission, even though maybe things that you took for granted for being available, they're not available. Or tools that you thought you'd have, you no longer have. Or it's not happening in the way that you wanted it to happen, but you're still able to get the job done. And so resilience is one of those things that I thought was always important, that transformed my life and is able to be passed on. But one of the other things that I think was important that they gave me was the ability to create. The ability to hold nothing but chaos in your hands and yet somehow build something incredible or beautiful or useful out of it. So there are so many times in our lives that all of a sudden we were moved to the other side of the country, or all of a sudden a dictator on the other side of the world decided to do something nobody else thought they should do, and all of a sudden my dad needed to be deployed for an extended period of time, and just different chaotic or different unpredictable situations that would come up, and all of a sudden you're holding chaos, you're holding problems in your hand. And how can you bring something beautiful or useful out of them? And I can't tell you how many times we had uncertain timelines or uncertain finances or uncertain stability in the family, depending on who was in town or who couldn't be in town, that my parents still put a life together for our family that was beautiful and transformative. And in some ways, ended up, at least with their youngest child, a nurse and a bomb technician coming together to make a preacher. I don't know how it happened. My mother doesn't know either. But it's one of those that I like to think that maybe both of their jobs, taking bombs apart or putting people together, takes a lot of prayer, you know? It takes a lot of thoughtfulness, and maybe those foundations of faith maybe kind of rubbed off, but really what really brought me to faith and really brought me to my experience with God was seeing the way that they encountered difficulty and seeing the way that they were able to create life out of chaos. And that's something that I think we overlook so often. This idea that creation were these words or these moments of the very first parts of the book that we read in the Holy Bible, when really creation is something that holds us all together. That God is still in the creation business. God is still in the creation work. No matter how much it looks like life is falling apart, God is still the author that weaves things back together. And so when we came across the text for our Veterans Day service today out of the book of Isaiah, we come across the prophet in the last lessons that the prophet can teach, chapter 65 out of 66 chapters. What's the last story? What's the last lessons? What's the last point that I want to get across to the people? Now, the book of Isaiah, the prophecies of Isaiah, span an incredible length of time in history. All the way from the foundations of the nation of Israel to where they knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that God was with them, and they had a temple and they were a people and their borders were secure, and it was laughable to think that anybody could ever overtake or conquer the nation that God established. They had nothing to fear from the Assyrians or the Babylonians or any of the other enemies that used to push up against their borders, until eventually those enemies that they took for granted, the promises that they began to drift away from, all of a sudden led to armies knocking on their doors. eventually invading their cities, eventually marching across their borders and tearing down their houses and even burning their temple. Their world unraveling so much to the fact that not only are they conquered, but their conquerors take them, lift them up, and then transplant them back into their own land. So not only have we taken your homes, but now we're trying to take your identity, who you are. Your God no longer has a house or a home. You no longer have the God, the land that your God promised to you. Now you get to live like us, trying to assimilate them into a new culture and a new place. And eventually, over time, after much prayer, after faithfulness that stretched them to the very limits of where their faith could carry them, out of their exile in Babylon, the people of Israel are able to come home. And what do they find when they come home but the remnants of their destruction? Their houses still burned, their streets still torn up, their temple still looted and sacked and torn apart. And in the midst of that moment, the faithful question is, where is God? Now, we find ourselves with those same questions in our lives, where it seems like things were all of a sudden completely turned over, all of a sudden things are turned inside out, and everything that we thought was the way that things were going to go, when they get completely destroyed or wiped out, our questions are, how in the world did God let this happen? Where do we go from here? And part of that, I think, in Isaiah's message to the people in this final chapter, is, do you not know that God is still a creator? That God is the author of life and of hope and of peace. And that is not just a creation that starts in the very first part of time, the very first words of the book, but creation is what happens even in the most difficult moments of our life, that God still weaves things back together. And of course we go through trials, and of course we go through tragedies, and we go through course where everything that we thought of our world, everything that we thought of the way that things would go, completely get unraveled. And faith is God saying, watch me weave it back together. Watch me create something new out of what you thought was good, and create something so much better than we ever could have imagined. Creation is not just simply a moment that happens in time. Creation is something that God unfolds and God works and leads us into each and every moment of every day. And we are made in the image of God. Now, that has been translated in some unhelpful ways and some really helpful ways, but in the idea of who created us, the creator of all that we know and see in this world, created you. Created me, created each and every one of us, so that not just we could look like God, but that we could create like God. We could be the very character and the nature of God revealed to the world, and we get to join alongside God in that work of bringing hope together, of weaving joy into situations, of creating life and hope and love and peace where before there was all destruction. We don't have to wait on God to do it for us. God is waiting on us to join God in that work. That we get to be a part of the creation of making all things new. This promise in the middle part of the book, this promise in the last couple chapters of Isaiah, it reminds us of the very first promises from the very first part of the book, but it also echoes those promises in Revelation chapter 21. That God's entire work through all of scriptures is to make things new again. To create in us a new kingdom and a new life and new opportunities and a new salvation that we might have life with God. And we get to join together God in that work of building a kingdom of God that doesn't look like ourselves. It doesn't look like our own appetites and agendas of what we want this world to look like, but it begins to look like God. And what does God look like? Well, God looks like Jesus. God looks like the Word made flesh. God looks like a Spirit that would look down upon us and empower us in such a way that we're able to join in that work that transforms the world. Have you ever realized the power that you possess? The creative work that God has created and set free in you. Have you ever noticed how you have the ability to make somebody's day? But just as easily, you have the ability to crush somebody's day. Have you ever thought about the power that your words have to encourage someone and to strengthen somebody and to lift them up? And the power that your words have to tear things apart, to divide, and to kill. We wonder why our words have so much power. We wonder why our actions have so much power when we're living in the shadow of the one who's created us, whose very words spoke all of this into existence. And those words are created new in each and every one of us every day. And our responsibility, our joy, our work as followers of God to join God in that work of building something new, something amazing, something that gives life. One of my favorite memories that I have of a kid is my mother just waiting till my dad went TDY or went out of town for a couple weeks. Because one thing that my mom loved to do more than anything else when my dad went out of town is she had a list of projects that she wanted to get done. And it might ever be everything from tearing out some cabinets to removing some wallpaper or doing a landscaping project of some kind or even knocking out a wall maybe. She'd have a list of projects that she wanted to get done that the old sergeant major was not knocking off as quickly as she thought he should. So she'd wait till he went out of town. And after he went out of town, maybe be gone 3 to 6 hours, she would get us out of bed, and man, we would just go into demolition mode. Tearing things apart, knocking holes in things, digging holes, doing everything that we could to not complete the project, but just get it far enough over the line that once he came home, he couldn't go back. He had to finish it. He had to join us in the work of making something new, right? Because the reality is that when we come to situations in life, we don't know what tomorrow brings. We don't know what next week brings. We don't know what the next month brings. We don't know what situations we're going to walk into when we walk out the door and walk back in. There's any number of things that seem like they've gotten completely taken out of our control. But the reality is we don't know what tomorrow brings, but we know what the last tomorrow brings. We know what the ultimate outcome is, and faith is just walking in those in-between steps. It's us knowing that God has an ultimate goal and an ultimate purpose, and that is to be with us. And God is doing everything we can to take all of the pillars that God has created, all the threads that God has woven creation together, and we have pulled on them, and we have crushed them, and we have thrown them away, and God says, I'll make something even newer and better. A place to where we can be together. To where death is no more. Sickness is no more. Sadness and disappointment and frustration is no more. A time when war and rumors of war are no more. I believe every veteran in this room lives for a day in which swords will be beaten into plowshares, in which peace will reign. And we as Christians get to join God in that work. And not seeing creation as a moment that happened in the past and wondering where God is now, but joining God in that work today of making all things new, of building life and hope, purpose and peace into every situation we go, carrying that very creation of God in every touch and every word and every opportunity, creating a new world alongside with God. Amen. and amen. Amen. Will you pray with me today? Almighty and gracious God, we give you thanks. Lord, we give you thanks for your word. We give you thanks for your Son. We give you thanks for your Holy Spirit that show us the character and the nature of your life, Lord, your kingdom. Lord, as we join you in the work, allow us to build a kingdom that looks like you. Because, God, we have made ourselves to be terrible gods when we try to make a world that looks like us. God, we have divided ourselves, we have killed ourselves, we have pushed ourselves to the limit to even steal humanity from each other. And so, God, you said you would make something new. A life to be together. Help us to join you in that work, that we might be a part of the first taste, the first transformation, and the first testimony of the kingdom of God in this world. As we pray all these things in Jesus' name, amen and amen. Will you rise as you're able for our closing hymn this morning? O God, our help in ages past. So to all of our veterans, thank you for your service. Thank you for all that you've done. But may we go as Christians and believers to continue the work of peace, of life, of hope, of joy, to join God in the work of making all things new. Let us go in power. Let us go in hope. Let us go in the very image of God for the world to see. Transformation happens in our lives. Let us go pour it out into the world. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.